Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Celebrating Pearl Primus. I'm Michael Sakamoto. I'm an artist, curator, scholar, educator, and also the performing arts curator and the director of the Asian and Asian American Arts and Culture Program here at the Fine Arts Center. And it's my pleasure to honor to welcome you to what is actually our first in-person event in our theaters back since March 2020. And this is also our first in-person event of our regular season this year in 21-22. So please make sure to grab our brochure or just check our website simply at fineartscenter.com to see all of the great music, dance, and theatrical events we have between now and the end of April. And for those of you especially interested in dance, while we are now, unfortunately or fortunately, as the case may be, sold out for next week's two performances of Bill T. Jones, Arnie Zane Company's Afterwardsness, there will be still this season a free work in progress performance by acclaimed contemporary dance and Yupik Nation artist Emily Johnson on Monday, February 28th with her collaborators right here in Bowker Auditorium. And plenty of seats left for the always glorious Alvin Ailey American Dance Theater on Tuesday, April 26th on our main stage performance hall down the walkway at the Barramuri Center for the Arts. And for those of you who don't know what the building that for the longest time, of course, was specifically named the Fine Arts Center, which our organization is still named in case there's any confusion, it has now been renamed for Randolph W. Barramuri, who was the first African-American chancellor and who actually was presiding over UMass during the building of the what was originally called the Fine Arts Center. So we're doing that in his honor. We also begin this evening by stating that the University of Massachusetts Amherst acknowledges that it was founded and built on the unceded homelands of the Pocumtuk Nation on the land of the Norwatuk community. We begin with gratitude for nearby waters and lands. We recognize these lands and waters as important relations with which we are all interconnected and depend on to sustain life and well-being. The Pocumtuk had connections with these lands for millennia. Over 400 years of colonization, when Pocumtuk peoples were displaced, many joined their Algonquian relatives to the east, south, west, and north. That includes Mashpee and Aquinnah Wampanoag, Nipmuc, Narragansett, Mohegan, Pequot, and Mohican communities, and the Abenaki and other nations of the Wabanaki Confederacy. These native peoples still maintain connections and relationships of care for these lands today. We also acknowledge that the University of Massachusetts Amherst is a land-grant university. As part of the Morrill Land-Grant Act, portions of lands from 84 native nations west of the Mississippi were sold to provide the resources to found and build this university. As an active first step toward decolonization, we encourage you to learn more about the native nations whose homelands UMass Amherst now resides on and the indigenous homelands on which you and all of us live and work. We also invite you to deepen your relationship to these living lands and waters. And because we're also live streaming this event this evening, we further acknowledge through language courtesy of Groundwater Arts that this event's virtual platform, YouTube, is headquartered in what is commonly known as San Bruno, California, on the traditional lands of the Ohlone, Ramaytush, and Muwekma peoples. Because the digital platform is made possible by physical land and the indigenous people who steward it. Also, before introducing our guests, unfortunately, we must bring your attention to the ongoing challenges, traumatization, and yes, violence endured by UMass students and other community members of color and all gender identities. We are saddened and frankly disgusted by incidents over the past weeks of both alleged sexual violence and the very public anti-black racism online and in person here on campus. The Fine Arts Center stands in solidarity with black and women's students organizations and other allied campus groups in reiterating our ongoing commitment to anti-racism, anti-violence, gender justice, and social justice, and the dismantling of white supremacy and the decolonization of our institutions, because no one is safe until everyone is. Black lives matter and believe survivors. And now, the reason you're all here, celebrating Pearl Primus. I'd like to quickly thank all of our co-presenters, so not only the Fine Arts Center, but also the UMass Amherst Library Special Collections, UMass Dance Program, and partnership with Five College Dance. So thank you very much. I'm not going to waste everyone's time by reading Pearl's bio or listing her many amazing accomplishments. You have the program notes, and the film and panelists will fill in all of the beautiful intangibles of so much else that made Pearl a great historical figure and great human being. I will simply hand off the mic to one of our special guests this evening, photographer, printmaker, filmmaker, and former photojournalist, Stan Scherer, a former colleague and friend of Pearl's, who has worked and exhibited in many countries worldwide and who will introduce tonight's film. Stan?
Thank you all for being here, and thank you to Michael Sakamoto and the staff of the Fine Arts Center for organizing this event. And Pearl was a force. Those who knew her were swept up by her power, her charm, her brilliance, her strength, and so much more. My wife Marjorie and I first met Pearl in 1985 and became very close friends with her. I worked with Peggy and Mary Schwartz in 2009 to prepare the photographs for their wonderful biography of Pearl, The Dance Claimed Me. They had gathered an enormous amount of archival materials, photos, audio and video recordings, papers, newspaper clippings, and the like. Soon after, I began thinking that we could make a film about Pearl using this material to tell her story as much as possible in her own words. And so, here we are. Thank you very much.
Welcome and thank you for it is your love that has brought me back home. Thank you. I dance not to entertain, but to help people better understand each other. Because through dance I have experienced the wordless joy of freedom, I seek it more fully now for my people and for all people everywhere. Dance is my medicine. It is the scream which eases for a while the terrible frustration common to all human beings who, because of race, creed, or color, are invisible. Dance is the fist with which I fight the sickening ignorance of prejudice. It is the veiled contempt I feel for those who patronize with false smiles, handouts, empty promises, insincere compliments. Instead of growing twisted like a gnarled tree inside of myself, I'm able to dance out my anger and my tears. Dance has been my freedom and my world. It has enabled me to go around, scale, bore through, batter down, or ignore visible and invisible social and economic walls. I had wanted to be a medical doctor and was well on the way to really going into that career. I took at Hunter College biology and pre-medical major with health sciences as a minor. And because I was so very, very active, I guess the dean gave me the privilege of, of taking health and phys ed to keep me out of trouble.
Did it work?
Oh, yes. It certainly occupied my physical time. And not only that, I think possibly it helped to sharpen the coordination, the physical coordination that enabled me to become the dancer that I did eventually become. I excelled in track and field. And sometimes as I performed in the concerts later on and took the running broad jump in Hard Times Blues, the audience didn't realize it was the running broad jump. You know, I was climbing the air. Really, it's absolutely a magnificent feeling to climb the air. And when you reach the top, pause before you come down. And the audience is just thrilled at that point.
I first met Pearl in 1980. Murray was looking for a dean of a Black Studies college at the University of Buffalo, State University of New York at Buffalo. She was brought in to interview for a position. My piece of that was arranging for a little dessert party after we took her to dinner at a very elegant restaurant in downtown Buffalo. We got back to the house and I had made a pavlova, which I thought was very, very fitting to make a pavlova for another diva, Pearl Primus, and it worked. It puffed up the white paste of the white meringue with the fruit. It was quite beautiful, and everyone was delighted with that. But the highlight of the evening was her engagement with our youngest daughter, who was stretched out on the couch reading, quote unquote, a book. Pearl sits down next to her to ask her what she's reading, and the book is upside down, and she's very busy pretending to be reading. Shortly after Pearl died, that was just an incredible event in our lives, certainly. And shortly after that, I wanted to meet Joe Nash. I had heard her mention his name so many times and we'd never met. Well, it was quite an experience and a treasured one.
How I first met Pearl and our earliest days together. You're having me to go back to a time when many things were happening in the dance world that neither of us were aware of, but later years it would become very important in our mutual histories. I was working at CBS in communications when I heard about a dance unit that was being formed also under the auspices of the National Youth Administration. Now, this was a federally funded program to introduce youngsters to a discipline so that they could get on-the-job training. Well, from CBS down to this building on the Lower East Side, I went. Perhaps you're familiar with the Delancey District, the Lower East Side. Well, there was this old building that was the headquarters for this NYA dance unit. So I was in the process of rehearsing with the group, and it was at a break in the rehearsals when I went into a vacant room and was doing my stretches at the bar. All of a sudden, I looked up, and there was this short girl, dark-skinned girl, standing in the doorway, eyes popped open, looking at me doing my stretches. And she said, "I'm Pearl Primus. I am dancing with the..." I said, "What? You a dancer?" I couldn't believe that she was a dancer. She did not have the body of a dancer. Years later, her son used to say to me, Onward would say, "Joe, did you say all those nasty things about my mother when you first met her?" I said, "No, you know, a 17-year-old, so self-assured, naturally will be express a little bit of conceit about themselves and others." But once we started rehearsals, Pearl turned out to be such a delight. She had a bubbly personality, and there was such a joy in what she was doing. It radiated throughout the rehearsal space. So, and she had no previous experience as a dancer. That's another thing that amazed us. She just picked up things naturally. So we rehearsed this with this group, the NYA dance group, and we appeared at the World's Fair, and it was really a series of dances telling the story of American social dancers throughout history. It was nothing technical. It did not require great dancing on our parts, But everybody would enter into the proceedings with great feeling of delight, because they would stances, like we would begin with the minuet, we would go to the Virginia Reel, we do the cakewalk, and then we wind up with the Lindy Hop, something like that. So Pearl was right at home and was able to pick up. So our relationship began with that NYA. But Uncle Sam sent me a greeting, said, "You are being drafted." So by 1941, the NYA had disbanded. And while in Europe, in the hedgerows of France, between bathing in my helmet and between walking around the grounds with a carbine rifle, a paper arrived, the headline, "Pearl Primus, Dance Debutante, number one." I said, "That can't be Pearl Primus, the Pearl that I used to dance with." She never aspired to be a dancer. She wanted to be a pre-med student.
These people always imagine black people that had nothing to do with what you would call creative dance that could be created on social issues. And therefore, I was guided by her philosophy in changing the mindset of people in America that we do have something to offer. We do have a history. We do have roots in dance. And she used her basic philosophy of protest and to dance it and to tell her story. And I like that. And she investigated facts on the origin of black dance, African dance, Afro-Caribbean dance. And this is why I was drawn to her, because I was very interested in that.
Pain so bad, Lord, my heart was sore. Folks had nothing but a sin and a shame. Everybody said all our time was a blame. Great God, I'm not supposed to be in the bed. Lost everything they ever had. Great God, I'm not supposed to be in the bed. Lost everything they ever had. Now the sun wasn't shining 14 days and no rain. Oh, and planting was all in vain. They had hard times, Lord, all around. Field barrels and crops burnt to the ground. Great God, my folks be in the bed. Lost everything they ever had. Great God, my folks be in the bed. Lost everything they ever had. Lost everything they ever had. Then I went to the boss at the commissary store. Folks all starving, please don't close your door. We want more food and a little more time to pay. Boss man left and walked away. Great God, my folks be in bed. Lost everything they ever had. Great God, my folks be in bed. Lost everything they ever had. Now your landlord coming around when your rent is due. And if you ain't got his money, take your home from you. Lost everything they ever had.
And years later, when I came out of the service, I said, "Pearl, are you the same Pearl that I read about in the New York Times?" She said, "Yes." And so right away, we reestablished our contact. But it was from that period, the World's Fair performance in 1939. I was drafted in 41. So in the meantime, her career blossomed between 1939 and 1943 when she made her debut.
Omo Wale. Omo Wale. Child returned home. Child loved by all. Child returned home. I am Omo Wale. Omo Wale. Child returned home. Child loved by all. Child returned home. I am Nkoyo, Ariowa, Adaora, J Bundu, she who goes before the ceremony to clear the ground of evil. I am Omo Wale, child returned home. Child who embraced the great mountains of Ife. Child who bathed in the mighty Congo River. Child who walked the red earth, the soft brown earth, the black earth, yellow sands, white sands of Africa. I am Omo Wale. Child who lived again with my brothers and sisters. Lived and worked, laughed and cried, ate and drank, played, danced, hoped, thought, planned for tomorrow. I am Omo Wale.
There was a period in the 1960s into the 70s where Pearl and Percy were separated. It wasn't billed as a formal separation, but he took a position at SUNY Binghamton, and she was in New York City and very, very active with the New York Board of Education. They had hired her to do a curriculum project for this city, which would then go into the public schools. Essentially, you could say that she was the pioneer of the lecture demonstration form. There were other groups, other artists that had done some in the public schools, but Pearl took it to a fine art, and she would be dressed in all of her African finery and would have drummers with her. And they would make their entrance into an auditorium, and right away kids would pick up the rhythm of the drums and and respond to her. The drama with which she told stories and narrated, and she was in great demand throughout the public schools. She certainly made her mark on education, and the work that she did became a model for lecture demonstrations, which are now very much part of curriculum that are brought into schools throughout the country. In the 70s, she was beginning to become aware of wanting to impart some of her work to dancers that she felt had the strength of a physical strength and the artistic clarity to convey it. She taught Judith Jameson Fanga and set work on the Ailey Company, and also wanted to complete her PhD at NYU, and that she did in 1978, and movement. Her dance movement was accepted as part of the language requirement for the PhD, and she was very, very insistent and very proud of that. That was very clear to her that needed to be honored. So there were very great highs for her in the late 70s. She and Percy reunited as a company and as a team, and they had the Riverside concert, took it to Perry Street. And then in 1979, Percy died, and her life changed dramatically.
It began in 1980 when I was the dean of what were called the colleges. These were experimental, theme-based colleges, residential, at the State University of New York in Buffalo. And we needed a master for what was called the minority college. It was a college of about 300 students, almost all black students. And I got a resume, 35 pages thick, in the mail from Pearl Primus. I didn't know who she was. But seeing that she was a dancer with enormous experience, I brought it home, showed it to Peggy, and Peggy said, "You have to hire this woman." Then in 1983, we left Buffalo to come to the University of Massachusetts in Amherst. And at the time, the chancellor was Joseph Duffy, who had been the head of the NEH before he came to the university. And so with his help, I was able to bring Pearl to Amherst as a five-college professor. And she was based at Smith College, where she lived above the faculty club until she retired in 1992.
Now, children learn. They learn, sometimes we don't even think they're learning. A child learns when that child is sitting on your lap. If you are in a culture where the child is carried on the back or on the side, the child is learning. It's learning a rhythm. It's learning the rhythm of walking. It's learning a rhythm of dancing, of turning, of bending. The child is learning through movement. We don't realize that. There is a movement, I understand, in America to have the child closer to the adult world. That is, don't put the child in the cradle way out there, two or three rooms away from you, because the child needs to have your body movement as part of its learning. They say security, but we know it's that whole learning process. In various cultures, among your Mano, for instance, in Liberia, that child is strapped to the back. And as the mother dances in the ceremonies, or as she goes through the dramatic movement of fear, because she pretends it's a drama in that culture, that when the great masks come out, certain people must run away as if in fear. The child learns that too, learns the movement on the back. When it comes to praying, the child knows that you don't just fly up in the air and bang on the sky or wherever you have put God and say, "God, listen." No, there's a way of approaching. And that approach is also learned through dance. The person pounding the corn, and you will see some pounding, I will tell you how I laughed yesterday when I saw those different ways of pounding. You see it? They're pounding. And as they pound, they decided they are receiving something. The grain is being mashed, or the cassava, or whatever it is being mashed. They are receiving something. Suppose they pound so that the eye of the great creator would fall upon them. And they would be saying, "We are ready to pound, we are ready to do this work," without even receiving any physical gains. And they go through the motions of pounding and pounding, and then a sound would come from them, and it became a dance. Dance then, which has that spiritual result, not necessarily that physical result.
Thank you. meeting tonight.
Tonight.
We gotta hold a meeting tonight.
Tonight.
We gotta hold a meeting tonight so we can straighten out the business at hand. Yes, we are gonna learn a new thing.
We are gonna learn a new thing. We are gonna learn a new thing.
A rhythm and a rock.
And a rock that rhythm.
So we come out tonight.
Rock and
I said we come out tonight.
Rock
you know we come out tonight.
Rock and
whoa.
Rock and
oh, it ain't no harm.
Rock
and no, it ain't no harm. Pearl had what she called a quote unquote a dream deferred, which is taken from Langston Hughes' poem. She wanted. After she was part of several companies during the time I was with her, she wanted to create an institute for what we would call the Pearl Primus Dance Language Institute, and it was incorporated. She wanted to have students that could acquire not only artistic training, but academic training also.
During her time in Amherst, Pearl was endlessly active. She taught her classes on different campuses. She arranged for speakers at the New Africa House at the university. She was living above the faculty club at Smith College, and she did a lot of things there. She taught at Paradise Pond, a beautiful setting for her classes, which were enormously popular. Her appointment, though, was a year-by-year arrangement, and she was not always making her colleagues and the faculty happy. She wasn't fully accepted, I have to say, by the dance departments because she didn't fit the usual mold of a dancer in the academic world. And she wasn't fully accepted by some of the anthropologists because her style of anthropology was more a style of storytelling rather than academic research. But she had a lot to say, and the students appreciated her enormously.
This is a special recording of drum rhythms for 7 dance studies of the Pearl Primus Percival Board School of Dance, 17 West 24th Street, New York City. These 7 dance studies were taught at the Connecticut College School of Dance, New London, Connecticut, this summer 1968, and are being taught at the Harkness School of Ballet Arts, New York City. On drums are Percival Board and Russell Robertson. All classes were taught by Percival Board.
During her time in Amherst, Pearl set one of her most famous dances in Penusa on the Alvin Ailey Company in New York. And so she would travel to New York for rehearsals, and sometimes Peggy would go with her. Sometimes I had the privilege of going also. And then the performance came, and it went beautifully. It was a winter night, and there was a light snow falling in Manhattan. And after the performance, we all left through the theater back door. Pearl handed me an 8-foot-long spear and told me, "You have to take care of this. This was Percy's spear." Percy, her husband, had used it in the dance, and she continued using it in her performance. So there I was, walking with a group of people down Manhattan Street with light snow falling, carrying an 8-foot spear, and I soon realized that everyone who passed kept their distance from me. And looked strangely at me, and I realized that a good way to protect yourself in Manhattan is to carry an 8-foot African spear.
Now comes my part. My time, we say, to greet you. My time to greet you in the language that I know best, the dance. You notice the open hands. I bear no weapons in my heart for you. And from my heart to you, all that is good in me, and from my head, what I can think of for your comfort, you are welcome. When you see the dancers coming down from the bush, coming through the tiny paths, dancing, they're asking the earth to lend of itself. They're asking the drums to give of the voice, and they're asking the sky for blessings, so that when they come before you and dance, you are welcome. Into the yard they go and find the hen, the chicken for your pot. You need ask nothing, for you are welcome. For this particular dance, I was decorated with the Star of Africa, because they say that the feet did ask the earth, and the hands, the drum, and the sky. Kibidi yum yum yum. Welcome. The dancers are coming. In, in. Kibidi yum yum yum.
Thank you.
By the early 1990s, even as her prodigious energies began to wane, she transmitted her most groundbreaking dances, such as Shango, to Linda Spriggs, Hard Time Blues, Negro Speaks of Rivers, Strange Fruit, and Empanuza, to younger performers. And the other person that was filmed that you'll see in this film is Donald Washington, and I first encountered Donald. I had not known him before Pearl died, and he came onto the stage at the podium at the service for Pearl in a red scarf, very dapper looking and very handsome young man. And he spoke so eloquently, and he talked about when Pearl entered a room, heads turned, and he turned and was very dramatic. And when she did such and such and such and such, heads turned. And I just knew I needed to hear a little bit more from him about what his experience was with her.
Let me put it this way. As I said last year at Dr. Primus's, I don't say memorial, but her passage ceremony, her celebration, as I said at that celebration, a key moment to answer that in the Ailey rehearsals with the Ailey dancers was when she was mounting Empanuza, she you know, rehearsed on and on and on, and frequently one rehearsal would be comprised of only a few movements because she wanted to refine them to exactly what she wanted. She was a perfectionist. She encouraged you constantly. You know, so she wasn't, she didn't let your spirit down because you weren't giving her exactly what she wanted, but she motivated you to try, you know, because these people have never been to Africa, most of them, have never experienced life as she had experienced it, to bring exactly what she wanted, but within what they had to offer, give me something in that direction. All right. One of the dancers, one of the lead male dancers, had a solo in Empanuza. And it was very specific, as I said before. And she rehearsed him for, I know, an hour. And so finally, at the end of rehearsal, he went up to her. And she was sitting on the bench, you know, in the rehearsal studio, the mirror, the big mirror behind her, and she was sitting there with her gele, and just all of this came to rehearsal, you know. And so he went up to her, wanting to please her soul, and said, and mind you, this was one of the divas of the company, all right, you know, gets it on the first go around. And he said, Dr. Primus, and he's half out of breath because he's been rehearsing this one step, jumps and leaps and turns and all of this. His stamina was being challenged here. So he said, Dr. Primus, how was it this time? And she looks at him. This is at the end of an hour of rehearsal. She looks at him and she, all the jewelry, I remember her hands, there was just all this jewelry, and she looks out at him and she says, "It's coming. It's coming."
Well, we did the company preparing for a tour. We rehearsed there for 8 hours, especially on the weekend, all day. We had to bring our lunch. She would go up to her apartment. She would give us stuff to rehearse while she was upstairs, and then she'd come downstairs and look at what we'd do. And she felt that we were moving ahead in the right direction, or we were still coming, as you would say. And she would then give you another step that you would go away and you'd work on, and then you'd come back. The other point is that when you got finished with her rehearsal at the studio, and that was from 8 in the morning to 8 at night, you couldn't walk down the stairs because your legs were so paining you from all the work that you were doing during the day. And we used to laugh and talk about that, you know, the company and whatnot. Generally, that the studio has a lot of memories for people who are apart.
Part-time protest. Protest against anything that displeases us. Protest against lynching that takes us to the air in our anger. Protest against a system that creates sharecroppers that take us to the ground in our anger. Protest. Hard time blues.
I've had my ups and my downs. I've fallen through the cracks, bruised my knee, banged my head. I have faced prejudice, hatred, anger, defeat of all kinds. Yet, I made it to the top. This is my message to you. Langston Hughes also wrote, "Hold fast to dreams. For when dreams die, life is a broken-winged bird that cannot fly. Hold fast to dreams. For when dreams go, life is a barren field covered with snow. When you go out there, when you're faced with mountains that you think you cannot pass, when people doubt you, when they say not only that you can't, but you won't, when you seem to face sure failure, remember that little girl and say, she made it to the top, and so can I. She made it to the top, and so can I." They tell me this story. They say that long before time was, long, long time before time was, Earth women could not dance. And that was a terrible thing, that Earth women could not dance. Of course, it would be terrible at any time. But at that time, it was really dreadful. You see, the people of Bani, Nigeria, live by fishing. The industry is a fishing industry. And the men go out in large canoes and fish. Now, we here say that if men go out fishing and do not return, we say that they are lost at sea. But the people of Bani knew better. The women of Bani knew better. They knew that out on an island far, far out at sea lived the most beautiful women. Women so beautiful. And those women danced. They danced. Of course, no Earth woman is going to stand for such foolishness, that men going out to sea would go and visit these very beautiful women. And because they were so very beautiful, the men would stay with them. To us, perhaps lost at sea, but to the people of Bani, Nigeria, these men forgot their homes on the land and stayed out on the island with these very beautiful women. I tell you, they were so beautiful that Father Neptune himself, Olokun, would sit on the shores all day long, forgetting that he had work to do at the bottom of the sea. Well, the Earth women got together. What if... Ha! And I didn't tell you, did I? That from the waist up, they indeed were beautiful women. But from the waist down, they were indeed beautiful fish. Earth women said, those fish women do not have what we have. We'll have to do something about this terrible state of affairs. They dressed one of their finest members in invisible garments. They dressed her in the invisible garments of the earth. And they built a magic canoe that was also invisible. And out this woman rode to the island of Mers. Well, she pulled herself together and learned the dance, jumped back in her magic ship, and back she went to land. Back she went, rowing, 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 rowing back to the earth, rowing back, rowing, 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 and there, on the land, all the women were standing, waiting for her to tell the secret. They couldn't believe it. Dance? What is that? Never mind what that is, she said. Whatever it is, that is what they're using to keep our men. Let us quickly learn something about this thing. I've learned the secret. Let me teach it to you, and we'll go out there. And she taught them all the dancing. And because Earth women have what fish women don't have, they were able to take the garments of the earth and turn and swirl, throw a leg over here, twist the leg here, because as you know, fish women do not have legs at all.
I've known rivers. I've known rivers ancient as the world and older than the flow of human blood in human veins. I bathed in the Euphrates when dawns were young. I built my home near the Congo, and it lulled me to sleep. I looked upon the Nile and raised the pyramids above it. I heard the singing of the Mississippi when Abe Lincoln went down to New Orleans. And I saw its muddy bosom grow all golden in the sunset. I've known rivers, ancient, dusky rivers. My soul has grown deep like the river.
Hello. I don't know that I can follow that voice. My name is Aaron Rubenstein, and I'm the head of Special Collections and University Archives here at UMass. Thank you all. And as I was saying before, but before the mic was on, I wanted to welcome you all and thank you all for being here. This is the first in-person event that I know I've been part of, and certainly the first in-person event for the Fine Arts Center for this season. And it is really powerful to be able to actually share space with people. So I'm so glad you are all here, and I'm incredibly honored to be part of this event and to even be warmed by the smallest of heat from the great flame of Pearl Primus's legacy. This is a celebration of Pearl, and we have an absolutely fantastic panel. So I'm not gonna speak long, but I do wanna take a moment to share my deep gratitude and to celebrate Peggy and Murray Schwartz, who, yes. As Stan Shearer explained, you saw clearly in the film, the genesis of the documentary that you saw came from the material that Peggy and Murray had collected as they were putting together their really fantastic biography, The Dance Claimed Me. And it was clear to Stan that this material was more than just illustrations in a book. It was living. And that film clearly demonstrates the life that is in that material. One of the biggest challenges for archivists is how do you take material that is in boxes on a shelf and bring it to life? And you know, this sounds sort of like a cliche, but it's actually much more than that, because these pages, this paper, represents people's lives and their connections and their communities. So how do you find that in an archive, and how do you bring that out? And the nature of the collection that Murray and Peggy donated to the Special Collections right actually before the pandemic started, so in a way this is kind of a delayed celebration, but a very powerful celebration nonetheless. It came out of their personal relationship with Pearl. So it is the story of Pearl, but also the story of their connection to Pearl, and their lives intertwined with hers, and they were like so many people, and from the stories that I've heard, even before this event started, everyone who met Pearl was changed by her in some way. So the true power of the material in this collection is that it, like we dream of in an archive, it brings the story and the legacy of Pearl forward. It shares the process that they went through when they were putting together Pearl's story and expressing it through their book. It shines through the documentary that we just saw. And now it is part of the permanent collections at the university, accessible to students, and to be shared not only on campus, but also across the whole world. Some of the interviews, the full interviews with Joe Nash and Donald Washington are already online and available through the Special Collections, and many more of the fantastic photographs and performances and other really incredible life-changing material that is in this collection will also be available online for free. So this is just the beginning of the sharing of Pearl's legacy through the material that Peggy and Murray have collected and donated. And I'm very excited about what this means for the future of understanding Pearl's legacy and for passing this incredible story on. So thank you both. I could not think of a more meaningful gift.
Sit here. Can you hear me? Okay. Okay. Just want to say how thrilled Murray and I are to be here and to be sharing this platform with other people, each one who has a different relationship and very, very meaningful, each person here has a very meaningful connection to Pearl Primus. She was not someone that you met lightly. If she took you in, she took you all the way in, and you were just compelled to give back fully. So it's quite a pleasure to be here. Can't thank Stan enough for the film. To see it on a big screen with an audience is just thrilling, and to see so much of her dancing is just wonderful. It was a privilege and a gift, and sometimes a job, and sometimes maybe even a difficult job, but it was work that we had to do and that we had to complete, and this is just a very culminating moment for me. I'm very, very moved and very grateful for people coming out during this pandemic when the campuses have been closed and there's so much else going on, but that you're here and we're here, and just full of gratitude for all of that. Thank you.
Good evening again. My name is Paul Dennis, and it is my honor to be sharing this stage as well. And we're going to have a conversation a bit about what we've seen and a lot about what you may not have seen, because like Peggy mentioned, Mama-san to me, everyone has a very different and close connection with Dr. Primus. So I invite a lovely conversation. I have some questions, as you know, but those would only be the springboard to what I hope would be a back and forth, a lot of interesting and lively conversation. And hopefully we leave a little bit of time in the end if anyone has any questions or comments, observations from the audience. I believe there are two mics, both at the end of the side aisle, that you can feel free to come on down and ask a question or make a comment yourself. So I'd like to start off, actually, with an introduction. Kim Beers, Michael Manswell, Imbere Escobar, Peggy and Marie Schwartz and Stan Scher. Again, welcome. So a question for each of you to answer, in no particular order. I mean, talk a little bit about your first impression. What drew you the first time you met Dr. Primus, so you read about her, or it might have been the resume that you read, or the first inclination, the first resonance that you had with Dr. Primus, if we can start there.
Waiting for her to finish dressing so that we can take her to the dinner at the restaurant that we were in. I'm sorry. Waiting for Pearl Primus to come down and rest for dinner when she first came to Buffalo. And it was a long wait, but she came down the stairs and she was as elegant and bedecked with all her finery as one could imagine.
So if you could hold the mic close.
Okay. Oh, I see. Tip the mic. Tip the mic. She was late. And she and that was the very first meeting. But she was so present when she arrived, and we just felt like we knew one another a lifetime, even before we left the house. So that was my absolute first memory of meeting Pearl Primus.
My first impression or first meeting with Dr. Primus was at Philippa Dance Company, Philadenko. And Dr. Primus came in on several occasions and did workshops and classes. So you knew you had to do your homework before any artist came in the door. What I knew is that she was a powerful voice, is that she used her platform beyond imagination. But when she walked in the door, she was so engaging and so open. And you just, you know, you saw this person who was this icon in the dance world that you never imagined that they would be that attainable. But she was very giving. And if I could say two words that came to mind and stayed in mind when I had an opportunity to work with her was intention and purpose.
I'd like to add to that Pearl was always teaching. She would frequently come to my office or come to our house, and she always had something with her. She would have an object, something she brought from Africa. She would be displaying these objects in her dress, in her body. She would tell a story. She had endless teaching stories about her culture and other cultures, and she was always inviting you to partake of these stories and to become part of the world she was presenting to you. People who know me know I'm always recommending books, so I'm going to recommend a book. It just came out. It's called A Fear and Strangers, A History of Xenophobia, by a wonderful man named George Macari. He explains that the notion of a stranger goes way back to early cultures, not because strangers were feared, but because there were rules of hospitality by which you had to welcome strangers. And she was a teacher who was both a stranger in that sense, who needed to be welcomed, and someone who was welcoming you into a different form of life. She thought of the dance as a form of life. In the tradition of Franz Boas and Margaret Mead, who she studied with at Columbia. So for her, the dance was an integral part of living, and every encounter she ever had with people was a form of life in which she was inviting and teaching so that you wouldn't be strangers.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
Great. Pearl arranged for me to fly with her to Barbados to document the elevation of the bishop to archbishop. That was Granville Williams. And we flew there together with her son, Anwen. And when we got off the plane, I saw it was clear the Queen of Barbados had arrived. She was treated as royalty. And everyone just worshiped her. And I'll talk a little later about the experience of observing her with the spiritual Baptist, but that will come a little later.
Hi, everybody. So glad that you all came out for this. I want to share a memory I have of encountering a photograph of Pearl Primus when I was a very young person, a young teenager. And her photograph was in an encyclopedia, a who's who of America at the time. And in the photograph, which I think is included in your archive and used in the film, it's one of the more iconic photographs of her jumping. And you can see the height that she's reaching in that jump. And when I saw that photograph, I saw an image of black female power and identity. And it stayed with me for a very long time. It inspired me to find out not only more about her, but the world of dance. And years later, I encountered her through my sister-in-law, Diane Gary, who danced in her company in New York, and also through my god-sister, Marcia Hurd, who was a dancer, but also a scholar, and was Mama Pearl's assistant at NYU when she was there. So these encounters were encounters that forced me to think more about her formation, something that I have taken up in my scholarship on Pearl Primus.
Good evening. My name is Michael Manswell, and I remember her sitting in Cheryl Byron's small apartment on East 89th Street, having her hair done. And I was told, you have to meet Ma Pearl, she is so. And I was a student at Brooklyn College at the time. And she asked me to sing thought, ooh, okay. And I knew that she was from Trinidad and Tobago, and I thought, well, okay, and I started to sing the song, and my first indication from her was, that's not the way it's done. And I was so embarrassed, but just to, the teaching, the ability to transmit knowledge without making you feel that you were total ignoramus and an idiot was her way. And it was that song that was actually on the film. I was singing for Irene Lay, and the words are, Ajajao. And so I was like, Ajajao. And she said, she said it is Ajaja. And I was spellbound. And she said to me, it means the fierce one, the ferocious one. So you cannot sing it Ajaja as it was a party. It's Ajaja. That was her.
Indeed.
It seems that that Dr. Primus really had a firm sense of identity and yet and that was further informed by her travels. How much of would you think that what she was learning in Africa, what she was learning when she went to the Caribbean, when she went to Trinidad, how much of that searching, that anthropology, was also about searching for herself, finding an identity, finding that strength? How much do you would you consider that searching was also about finding that strength? And that's for anyone.
I think when she went to Africa, she found it. She found that strength and she found her identity. When she came back, she embodied the cultures that had taken her in. Child returned home, brought that identity to America. And over the years of her teaching and her dance and her life, her identity began to bleed into American culture. She had an enormous effect. Peggy points out in our book that African fabrics, African colors, African designs were on display every day by Pearl Primus, and they've become part of our culture. African movements, African stories, African history. All of this was brought back in the embodied identity of Pearl Primus. And she carried it with her everywhere she went.
I also think we can't forget that she earned a PhD in anthropology.
Truly.
She was more than a keen observer. When I saw her in the churches in Barbados, she was watching people, but she wasn't simply watching them. She was looking into their souls. She was seeing into people. And I think that that's a distinguishing aspect of her anthropology research.
I also think that Africans born in this diaspora have an urge to reconnect, because somehow we are made to feel that because we're not continental Africans, that we're not the real deal. And one of the things that Cheryl would say to me that she learned from Pearl was that as a young child, or even as an old child, she would wake up in the morning and she would look in the mirror, and what she saw was Africa looking back at her. She didn't see China. And I think that those of us that are born in this diaspora, whether it be Trinidad and Tobago, New York, Amherst, wherever, feel that there is some invisible thread that ties us somehow. And we want to prove either to ourselves, to our communities, to the people that are observing us, that who and what we are intrinsically has not been forgotten. It rests inside. And I think that Ma Pearl found a way to make that triangle from Trinidad and Tobago to New York to Africa back to Trinidad and Tobago. And in that search, made those what people would think to be discontinued or not authentic threads to just uncover themselves to you, to their communities, et cetera, so that you could see those invisible threads that connect the world, literally. And as a way of doing that, you feel that authenticity that you've always had. You didn't just acquire it.
I'm going to direct this question to you, my sister Kim, because I know that as the dances that I've done, her choreography, you taught me. And I would love to hear a little bit an extension of what Michael was talking about. How did you find yourself in the dances? And certainly, how do you pass that on that's more than just the choreography? I mean, I know what my experience was like working with you, so. But I'd love to hear how you continue to do that, help dancers more than just learn a dance and learn the choreography, but really do anthropology and finding themselves through her work.
Exactly. Just piggybacking what Stan said about how she observed people, and not just your artistry on the outside, but who you were as a human being. The first time I had the privilege to work with her learning Strange Fruit and Negro Speaks of Rivers, as part of the ADF reconstruction series of this masterwork. The first time in the studio with her, it had nothing to do with movement. It was really about what I did realize is how much she had already observed me before that decision was even made. And it was a kind of stripping. Like, she didn't want me to come in the room as a Filadenko dancer. She wanted me to come in the room as a human being, open, willing to reveal every part of me before I could even start one step. And that was challenging. It was hard. It was because I was ready for the 5, 6, 7, 8. And you did not count when you was in the room with Mama. You didn't count. And again, purpose and intention. The first 3 days, all I did was walk from one end of the space to the other. But it was more than just walking. She wanted to feel purpose in my walk. She wanted to feel my vulnerability, my accessibility to finding out more about what that walk meant. And it was probably the most difficult, not probably, it was the most difficult, most challenging experience I'd ever had in my life. Because I went in the room with the wrong intention, thinking that this was just gonna be a choreographer bringing movement to me. Little did I knew that it was an investment in myself. Little did I know that that was a moment for me to really discover that this was my purpose in life, where I was supposed to be. But it was, she needed you to come to it kind of stripped, really vulnerable and really open to not only her story, but how do you find your story within it? And again, as a young dancer, it's that moment where you wanted that acceptance or that approval. And my mom never raised a voice, but you knew when it wasn't enough. You knew when she wanted more from you. And so what that also helped me to discover is, what is my intention when I'm in the room? What is my intention when I'm on stage? And now as a teacher, what is my intention to my students? And so whenever I'm speaking her voice, her words, I have to also get my students to that point where it's not just about movement in 5, 6, 7, 8 is now about the intention and the purpose in which you have that you're bringing to the table. And so I try to recreate that or rediscover that over and over again when I'm in the room with my students, because it opened up a window of a voice that I did not know that I had through my artistry, an opportunity to really make change. I mean, she changed how people saw images. She changed conversation. She invoked conversation. It wasn't just about dance, and it was about her life. It was about how she lived life. And I didn't live that life, but she imparts some of that in me to allow me to then find my voice in it. And I'm so grateful for that opportunity, for someone to look deeper than just what was on the outside, to want to find out the deepness of my being, to allow me to be the best at what I could be in her work.
Often today, there are expectations that we have as black dancers. There was a time when the choreographer Sophie Manslow was criticized for having a black dancer cast in a piece about a Jewish shuttle. And what would you, how would you describe the expectations of the black dancer today that has been placed on either by the audience or the critics or society? How would you describe this expectation of a black dancer? What creates that expectation? How did Dr. Primus either uphold or break that apart? What was her relationship with that expectation during her day, and how has it been changed today?
Well, you had to eat brown rice and yam in the morning when you worked with her, because she knew that she was going to work you hard. And like Kim said, never raised her voice. Not like me, I'm a shouter. But she never raised her voice, but you would do it over and over and over. But it wasn't ever boring. It was never boring, and it wasn't mindless. However, she would denude those expectations. I think black dancers then, I think Ma Pearl knew they had to be strong, like physically strong. But also you had to be mentally strong and psychologically strong and emotionally strong, because the vagaries of this world from the dance perspective was huge. You weren't given roles, you weren't in the old story. But dancers today are a little more, I hate to use this word, and my dancers would kill me if they heard me, a little more generic. They learn every style, they have to learn every style. And especially in New York, higher, faster, higher, faster, higher, faster, higher, faster, higher, faster, higher, faster. There's no artistry. There's no connecting soul, heart, hand, audience. It's always ta-da. But as you saw in the film, there was a certain kind of thread that she would gesture with that communicated to drummer, singer, dancer, boom. And I think this is what I try to do with my dancers. Don't just vomit out the movement for me. I want to see you. I want to see it. I want to see it in a different voice. That's my voice. My voice is boring. I hear it all the time. It's in my head. I want something else. And I think that this is what has changed.
Thank you. In my research on Primus, I had the opportunity to talk about the experience of setting, of having the works Fanga in the 1990s, but before that, the wedding, Fanga and the wedding in the 70s, and later Fanga and Impenyusa in the 90s on Alvin Ailey American Dance Theater with Sylvia Waters, who is the executor of Alvin Ailey's estate and the former artistic director of the second company. And one of the memories that Sylvia Waters shared with me as a dancer in the company in the 1970s was her encounter with Primus, which she feels changed her life and led her to develop a personal relationship with her. In her memories, she talked about the reaction of some of the dancers, these highly, highly trained dancers, as Michael mentioned, who are, you know, so steeped and so versed in diverse techniques of dance and performance, who did not expect to be challenged by Primus, who demanded that they not treat her choreography as just steps. And so she was up against an assumption that African dance choreography that drew on her anthropology, on her ethnography, on her own personal experiences of learning in the traditional manner from elders, and those especially chosen to learn dance in traditional African communities. This is what, as Peggy mentioned, she was transporting in her staging of this kind of work in the West for Western and then American audiences. So the idea that was prevalent for a very, very long time about African dance was that one could move in a frenzied, wild manner to approximate some kind of possession or some kind of sense of being out of one's body, then throw oneself on the floor. And that was the prevailing expectation and characterization of African dance for a very long time. And one of the things, to answer your question, Paul, that Primus changed was to reveal the intense technique that is embodied and presented in traditional African dance forms. That very, very little, while there is the element, the important element of improvisation in traditional African dance, but there is very, very little lack of technique in the development and presentation of African dance on African, in African communities and on African dance stages. So there's that. To piggyback on your comment, Stan, about Primus's anthropology, which is not talked about very much in discussions of Primus in her significance to American dance. But she absolutely made an extremely important contribution to American anthropology in that she insisted and based on her research, promoted the understanding of dance as a language that could never be just steps, right? That, as Michael mentioned, incorporates not just the physical body, but the mental, the psychological, and especially the spiritual. I would like to encourage, not much more time we have for conversation, so I would like to encourage those of you who perhaps are in dance, perhaps you are in African American studies or black studies, perhaps you are in anthropology, perhaps you are in sociology, to consider the range of her contributions to dance, to African American history, to anthropology, to American anthropology, to consider her contributions, to educate yourselves about her life, her work, and incorporate her contributions in your own studies, in those various disciplinary areas, because she is that deep and that important to understanding both American dance history as well as African American history.
You bring up a good point about how she went about imparting her knowledge. And everything that everyone has said, and even in the film, it is obvious that process was more important than product. If you all could mention how to change, what would you recommend to change the direction, as you were saying, Mbewe, in colleges, in the curriculum, in dance departments, to spearhead a shift that what's more important isn't the product at the end. I mean, that'll be there or not, but the process in it, and I'm sure each of you in your research and in your knowledge of Dr. Primus understood that, which is why she would give somebody, what was it in the film, one step to do, then she would go upstairs for 2 hours and come back. Because it wasn't about the step, it was about a process. But that's so far gone in today's curriculum. When, if you could talk about that or find an...
If I could mention just one thing, because my part of my background in dance is in African dance. And Michael, I'm sure you can speak to this as well. Traditionally, one learns from one's elders. You learn by imitation. This is not an approach that is valued in the teaching of dance in the West. Originality is valued, right? And technique is valued over this development that one gets from working very, very, very hard to not supersede your elders, but to reach a place, right, of recognition from the elders that you are learning from. And this is what Primus encountered in Africa.
Certainly, I think that the time that we're given as professors, you know, all of us here, 14 weeks, 28 classes, learn, you better learn it. And you better get a good grade too, because your mom, your dad, or whoever, paying, or the government, yeah? But just like Mbewe said, just like, you know, that we all know, I think, that Ma Pearl insisted, like those first classes, like even class with Mary Waith, it's always Mary and I have to talk through 3 hours, and you have to literally sit, let that body be silent. Don't talk, don't even have an opinion. Let it flow, and you just be the recipient, and let that percolate through your being. We don't have time to do that in college curriculums.
Because history and theory is separated out so often from technique work.
Absolutely, you know, and what I do, so my classes tend to be very long because, you know, I say to them, look, Primus did this, Dunham did this, Ailey did this, and they would sit and then, you know, we'd get back up again. But by that time, you know, it's like, Professor, I got a chemistry class, I gotta go. And so, unfortunately, we've lost some of that process. which is so important to feed.
A slight shift, but I'd like to just mention, I'd like to mention Pearl, how seriously she took working with children. So important, so important. She would sit children down, and the way she would approach them, they knew right away that they were being respected in a way that was that didn't always feel, and they were open to learning about their history and their heritage in ways that I never saw any other teacher reach. Those early years when I knew her, I was at a performing arts junior high school in Buffalo, grades 5 through 12. And right, so that and those youngsters were with us from age grade 5, so we were growing them up. Well, she came in and she just radically revolutionized how we were approaching their learning. From the cultural, from the family, from the side structure that they lived in, nothing was separate. Their whole life was involved, and she respected that and honored that, and just had a magic way of connecting with the young ones. So, always be so grateful for having shared that with her.
I think Pearl's performances had a universality to those performances. Even if it was African dance or the protest dances of the 40s, and she was speaking to specific things, nevertheless, there was always a universal language that she carried. And I think that's one of her really distinguishing characteristics.
So you spoke about time, Michael, and what I'm finding now in a university setting, that is kind of the norm. You think that there's no time, that you have to get through A, B, C, and D. But Mama's Pearl spirit is really strong. Sometimes I can be in a room and be in a flat back in a Horton technique, and then immediately I'm talking about her. And flat back stops, and we sit down, and we have conversation. And what I'm finding is, when I hear her in my ear, is that we can't say that there isn't time. That we have to, if we want to invoke that, if we want to share that, that we have to take that moment to do it, because if we don't pass it on, then there's not another generation to do that. If her legacy didn't mean anything to be continued, then why are we here? And so I find myself that I have to find time. And what I'm also finding is that the students are embracing it, that they want to go outside of just 5, 6, 7, 8, even when they don't have time. Or they'll come back to you and go, remember that conversation we started? So I feel like we have to, because there was never a time where Mama Pearl didn't. She didn't say there was no time, because time was definitely not a factor. I remember going into a studio with the birds chirping in the morning, and when I came out, the moon was out. And it was just me and her in the room, and I couldn't feel my pinky toe, my left ear, I couldn't feel anything, because it was just, and you didn't realize it until you came out of the space. But because she had a purpose and something to do, something to deliver, something to give, and we can't let time stop us from doing that and passing that on to the next generation.
Thank you. Not to succumb to time. The audience laughs, so they know what's going on. I actually have one, I'll say a final question for us to contemplate and discuss. There is a movement, there's been a movement for a while. It's not new today. This idea of decolonizing dance in higher education and on the proscenium stage and in dance education, you know? It's not just yesterday or 2 years ago, it's been for a while. In having met Dr. Primus in all the various forms in which you have, could you think of what would she say to this moment now? What would she say to this moment where we're looking to decentralize dance education out of the Eurocentric format in which we find ourselves. What would she say now from the perspectives of where you've met her? We don't have time, right?
I don't even think it's a matter of what she would say. I think it's a matter of what she would do. It would, what she would do, because it's action speaks, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, there's a moment in the film that we, where we hear her in her address at Hampshire College in 1985, commencement address, right? At Hampshire College in 1985, where she is imploring those students, right, to recognize her as a model and a forebear, right, in the, in connecting, in using dance and connecting dance to social and political issues, movements, and ideologies, right? She's saying to them, I made it and so can you. And yet, a few years ago, when Camille Brown gave the annual dance, Phi College annual dance lecture at Hampshire College, she talked about how she did not learn about Pearl Primus in her conservatory training. Institute shall remain unnamed in this moment. Okay, she did not hear of Pearl Primus, very little about Catherine Dunham, and nothing about Pearl Primus, but she investigated Pearl Primus on her own. On her own. And has, I think, I can fairly assume, has drawn on her to create the work that she has created in her attention to African American experiences and Black female experiences. So I would say that if she were able to speak to us today, it would be to not be afraid to make those connections, not be afraid to understand that in the same way that, you know, Black lives matter, that Black art matters, and Black dance matters, because it teaches us history. That without that kind of knowledge, we don't grow, we don't change, and we would continue to perpetuate the status quo, which is the colony.
Mm. Hello. Yes. I think in part, I am like in amongst the stalwarts here. I think one of the first things she would do, because she had this ability to defragment and not cause strife, speak her truth clearly, look her truth, and certainly communicate clearly her position. And at that point, there was nothing else you could do but agree. She was not threatening at all. And so she would walk into the room, and what would she do? Adonio, Adoni. Adonio, Adoni, and then she'd tell you what to do. Just like that. So what did she do? Erase the so-called hurdle, the isms, schisms, the things that keep us not human and apart. But she knew that dance, music, drumming, sculpture, fabric, all those things connected us. And so she was a walking masterpiece. Her fabrics from Eric Robertson, who would import these silk, these silk pieces from Africa for her for her specifically, and she would wear them. And in so doing, she then became that storyboard that Peggy is talking about, because the little kids would say, what's this? And then here comes the story. And so I think that if she were here and she had that kind of power, I think that, you know, once we observe that walking masterpiece, we would only be awed and be receptive.
I think there's a word for this: integrity.
Hello.
Absolutely.
She had an uncompromising integrity. That's one of the things she was telling the students at Hampshire. Not just I made it to the top, I got famous, but because I knew what I was up against, and I did it without ever compromising my integrity, which was true for every minute of her life that I ever saw.
Indeed.
Thank you. I actually want to leave a minute or two if any question or comment or observation, if anyone in the audience would like to come right on up to either of the mics or stand and shout loud. There is some light. I'd like to invite that, if there's anyone. Please. There's a mic there, I think, and there's one here, so you can choose your... You can shout. So the question is about her relationship with Percival Board or with Bill T. Okay.
Well, it means not just Percival, but almost every black dancer who came through that era learned fanga, and she was often quite distraught by that because there was so much bastardization of that piece, and that was her signature piece. There were dances that she told Percy he had to wait before she would teach him, that he wasn't ready for them, and then at a certain point she would then decide he was ready for a particular piece. And I'm blanking on the name of the piece right now, but he I think really felt overshadowed in much of their career. He also, and that she was really the moving force and the primary dancer, received a primary recognition over and above Percy's. So that's my sense of it from the letters that they exchanged that are in archives, and as well as the reviews of their work together.
From what I've gleaned from not only from Peggy but also from Mary Waith, and also from my virtually living with Cheryl, was that first of all Pearl was truly in love with this man. His physicality was a towering one, and she was truly awed by his physicality. And I think that being the thinker that she was and the anthropologist that she was, she saw where the two of them could become the power couple, and they could both become l'enfant terrible. However, I think, I do agree with Peggy, I think at some point there was some kind of parting of the ways where ego and so on just got in the way, but I don't think that she ever stopped
loving him and his physicality and the kind of awe that he would bring to the stage, especially with Impenusa, that when they observed the Watusi, the Rwandans, doing what they were doing, that she saw, Ma had real vision, you know. You know, if she told you you were gonna make it, believe it. If she told you you're gonna make it, you're gonna do this, believe it. She had real vision. And I think that in a way, I agree with Peggy, it kind of, it overshadowed him, but I don't think it was meant to. I think that she just really wanted to share all of this bounty that she had had and she had been exposed to, because she had lived here for more than 20 years before she met him on her return to Trinidad. And he was already a grown, formed man performing, you know, that own thing. Yeah, that Trini way. And I'm a Trini man, so I could tell you. We ain't easy.
There's a question down here.
It isn't really a question. It's just to say that the excitement and legacy of Pearl Primus will continue. The homage to Pearl Primus is going to continue next semester. Thanks to a donation that Peggy helped us acquire at the University Museum of Contemporary Art in the Bromley Center, February 3rd, we will have an exhibition where we bring out the extraordinary treasure trove of photographs, vintage photographs of Pearl Primus taken by the famous photographer Barbara Morgan. It's an exhibition being curated, co-curated by Aston McCullough, who is assistant professor in the dance department, and Amanda Herman, our education curator. So this kind of incredible dialogue will continue next semester, interdisciplinary dialogue, all with that springboard, that donation that the that Peggy Schwartz helped us acquire. So there'll be about 20 or so photographs on view.
Always there.
There's a question.
I see. No? You're it.
You're it.
Thank you for this. This was beautiful. I am a dancer. I'm a choreographer. And I'm also a professor of sociology here at the university. I will teach this. I will use this whole event. I'll have
wonderful.
My students watch it. And I will share it with my colleagues. I appreciate it.
I'd like to say thank you to my friends and colleagues, and for you being here to experience this with us. I think we could all take a piece of this, if not the whole thing, and share it with our colleagues, share it with our students, share it with our peers, and have this legacy permeate into our education and into our cultures, our relationships. Thank you for being here. Thank you very much, Fine Arts Center, for putting this together. And thank you once again, everyone.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Peggy and Marie.